I'm Bishop Clement Amonkwasi and they're coming your way with Restful Living. Well, it's another year. I want to wish all our viewers a happy, happy, powerful new year. Well, decreed by my bishop of Victory Bible Church International, it's a year of supernatural transformation. And I want to re-echo the fact that this year, everything about you is going to be transformed for the better and for the best. And so I welcome you to a new year, I welcome you to a new time, a new season. Our God is a God of times and seasons. You have been able to sail through and power through the deep of every experience or every challenge, and God has brought you here. And if God has kept you alive, it means he has something in store for you. You shall not die, but you shall live to declare the works of God. And so God bless you for all my viewers and all those who've been sharing and are being a blessing to many people who are enjoying these nuggets of truth on restful living, a life worth living. Welcome to another year. May this year bring you success. May this year bring you a great understanding of the will and purposes of God for your life. May this year bring you to a place, a wealthy place. May this year bring you into a place of rest. May this year help you understand the wisdom of God concerning how to walk in his will and to get to the place which he has prepared for you in the name of Jesus. And it shall be so, because God is a God of times and seasons. And if your season has come, the Bible says in Psalm 1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in verse 3, it said he will bring forth his fruit in his season. Your season comes when your fruit bearing will be so massive that, you know, you wouldn't have room enough to contain them, I tell you. And so I speak into your life and I prophesy and say, this is what is going to be your portion in the name of Jesus. Anything that comes against you one way will flee in seven ways in the name of Jesus. And so let's get ourselves ready. Let's embrace this new year with hope and with confidence in the same God who has kept us till now. And that if he kept us till now and we are still alive, it means he has a purpose for us. Glory to God. So welcome one more time. Well, it's another season. It's another year. And like I said, I bring to you Restful Living, Life Worth Living. This streaming is geared towards helping people place their confidence and their trust in God, rest in him, rest in his promises, and see God bring them to pass. It's important. I also teach you how to know your path. The Bible says we should labor to enter into the rest. Labor and enter into the rest. Doesn't mean you work and work and work. That laboring means just finding your path of discovering revelations concerning how God wants you to be restful in the name of Jesus. So I pray for you that God will open your understanding to understand this kind of style, lifestyle in God, this kind of walk with God, where we rest in his rest, because God himself rested on the seventh day, and rest is the first thing that God sanctified and set it apart for us to observe. Welcome to your year of rest, that year of transformation. May it be your year of rest also, in Jesus' name. And so God bless you and God strengthen you. May you receive that grace to be able to power through every dip that you experience. And don't give up, because there's always a reward for those who seek him. The Bible says in Hebrews 11:6 that by faith, if we seek God, faith is the substance of things. So for Hebrews 6 says, and that those who please him, I want to paraphrase it, yeah? For without faith, it is impossible to please God. And he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder. There's always a reward. A rewarder of those who diligently seek him. God is always a rewarder. He always rewards. And I'm coming your way with a subject and a title that also has rewards, great dividends in it. Great dividends in this thing. And what is it? You can guess. Every year we have to spend time seeking God's face. And so in the first month, we use that time to prepare ourselves for everything that he wants us to know during the year. And so the first month is always, and it's not only us, it's not only Victory Bible Church, it's also, most churches do, that January is a month of prayer. We use January to see God's face, to prepare our hearts to understand his purposes and his plans. And so that's what we do. It is important to do that. And because he is the one who ordereth our steps, we must buy into his mind and know his purpose. So we will be at the right place at the right time and to meet the right people. It's very important. So you will not be deterred. I pray that God will help you and order your steps. You have to take those steps, and he orders the steps to be at the right place at the right time and to land in your restful place. Your Rehoboth is ahead of you, so don't give up. And so we're going to use this time to talk about prayer, and I've captioned it, when you pray, and when you pray, and when you pray. Jesus taught us how to pray, and when you pray, and he said a lot of things about prayer, which we'll be getting into in the whole of this month. But I would like for us to have a short theology of prayer, a certain basic understanding of prayer. So when we start, we kick off, we know that we are praying accurately. I don't want to give God a call and then can't hear him speak back to me. Hitherto, that's what many believers have been doing. Always just talking. They think prayer is a monologue thing, but prayer is a dialogue thing. You pray and God will have to speak back to you. You see? And we get to understand that prayer is not about just informing God of anything, according to Jesus. It's not giving God information because he knows everything. All right? But I believe that prayer is to position us in order to hear from God what is happening on earth here. All right? To hear from him. He knows it. And so when we communicate to him, he already knows, but he wants us to position ourselves to know how to go about it. It's very important, not just to inform God. As if God doesn't know what is going on. God really knows. He knows the ending from the beginning. That's what the Bible tells me and tells you too. Glory to God. Well, so welcome to a new year. So we're going to talk about and when you pray. But let's look at this short theology of prayer, which will be helpful to you. We use January to revisit our understanding and theology of prayer. It's important to have the right theology, because the way you relate to God will determine how you pray to him. The way you relate to God will determine how you speak to him. Yes, and how you communicate with him. The way you relate to God. So it's very important for us to revisit these things, all right? And so we're going to discuss about five components, all right? Five components to consider regarding prayer, five components. I'm just going to give you five things to consider regarding prayer. And that is going to form the foundation when we start to pray, all right? The foundation of prayer. And so get it right, okay? Get it right. Five components to consider regarding prayer. But as a form of introduction, listen to what I have here. Where does prayer begin? Certainly, it begins with an understanding of God. Who God is and what he does is of paramount importance in considering prayer. How a person prays discloses what he believes about God. How you pray discloses what you believe about God. If you think God is the author of confusion, that's how you're going to pray. If you think God is the author of sickness and disease and poverty, it comes out when you pray, you see? So your understanding about God, your prayer, how a person prays, how you pray, discloses what you believe about God and your understanding about God. What a person believes about God will determine how he prays. So it's very important for us to revisit our understanding and our belief about God. Who is he? Who is God to me? Well, how you relate to him, like I said, will determine how you pray. Our opinion of who God is will determine how we interact with him in prayer. Petitions which one would ask of God are determined by a thorough understanding of his nature and character. This understanding will define what one asks him to do. So that basic understanding of God is a foundation upon which we pray. Let's get to understanding better. Understanding the nature of God will help us in our petitions to him. God is a gentle, loving, and kind Father. God is a gentle, loving, and kind Father. If you don't know that God is a good God, if you still don't get it, you think God, like a woman in the Bible said, Naomi said, God had really not treated, had not been fair, to paraphrase it, you know, and he wanted his name, Naomi, to be changed, you know, to something else, to bitterness or so, you know. And what you believe about God, if you think God is the one, you know, everything, you know, in our world, people think that it's the act of God when they see all these hurricanes and tsunamis and this, you know, like fire burning in Australia and all that. And they say it's God, it's the act of God. They attribute it to God. God is not that wicked. But you get to know from scripture that there's an enemy of your soul, an enemy, someone who wants to bring you down, a personality who hates God and hates his people and will want to bring destruction, death, and sickness and disease upon God's people. God is not the author of sickness. God is not the author of any disease. And God will not teach you a lesson through sickness. He doesn't do that. If your understanding about him is so, it will determine how you pray. If you understand, you think God uses sickness to teach people some lessons, then why do we pray to be healed then? Why do you go to the hospital? Then you better leave. Don't go to your GP. Don't go to your hospital. Don't go to your, yeah. If God uses sickness, hear me again. If your understanding about God, that he's the author of sickness, and that you can make some people sick, all right, to make some people sick, then, and teach them a lesson, then you don't have to pray for the sickness to go. If you think God is the author of poverty, then we should stop providing people with stuff and helping people out of poverty because God is teaching them a lesson. Does that make sense? It might not make sense, but it makes faith. So if you have such belief system, you need a paradigm shift. You need to shift your paradigm. It's called worldview confusion. When your worldview about God is wrong, it will determine how you pray. So it's very important to get your theology right, theology about God, understanding who God is, in order for you to pray effectively, or else you will not be praying according to God's will. So know that God is not the author of everything that destroys. John 10:10 tells us clearly, equivocally clearly, that there's an enemy called the thief. Jesus calls him the thief. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. But I am come that you might have life, Jesus said. I am come that you might have life. So Satan comes to steal. Satan comes to kill. Satan comes to destroy. So the fires in Australia was not orchestrated and set off by God. It's an enemy who has done this. It's an enemy who has done this. And believers must rise up and change the way they think in order for them to possess their possessions and for us to pray his kingdom down. The kingdom of God is here in order to pray it into manifestation. Let's pray the kingdom to manifestation. But if you don't have a right understanding of who God is, you are going to pray amiss and you're going to pray anyhow. And that will not bring dominion. Your dominion mandate will not work. Remember, God has placed us here to have dominion. And so shall it be in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, let me continue reading something for you that will help you. All right. If we accept these attestations of God, that he is a loving, gentle, and a kind Father, If we accept these attestations about God, we will interact accordingly. Sometimes we can see what a person thinks of God by the way he interacts with him, isn't it? In the Old Testament, though, there are some prayers which have the ring of bargaining with God. Somebody like Jacob. Now, Jacob prayed a prayer here, which I would like for us to listen to. It has a ring of bargaining, as it were. It tells you Jacob's understanding about God at that time. Remember, at that time in Genesis chapter 28, he was running away from his brother, whom he's usurped, whom he's, how do you call it? He's cheated, he's conned, as it were. He's running from his twin brother Esau. And he got to a place where it's about 500 miles away, according to theologians, from where he lived. And he was somewhere in the forest, got a stone to sleep on, use as a pillow. And there God revealed himself to him. And after the revelation of God, the gates of heaven, heaven was open, and Jacob saw the glory of God and angels ascending and descending. And after seeing that, he prayed a prayer. And the prayer seemed to have a kind of, it tells you his belief system at that time about God. It's very interesting. I want to read that prayer to you. This is what he prayed. And in Genesis 28, yeah, Genesis 28, and from verse, I read from verse 16. Let's read from when he woke up from his sleep after seeing, having the dream. He said, "Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, 'Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know.' And he was afraid and said, 'How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven.' Then Jacob rose early in the morning and took the stone that he had put at his head, set it up as a pillar, and poured oil on top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel, but the name of that city had been Luz previously. Then Jacob made a vow. He made a vow in prayer, saying, 'If God will be with me and keep me in this way that I'm going, and give me bread to eat and clothing to put on, so that I come back to my father's house in peace, then the Lord shall be my God.'" Ooh, bargaining. "And this stone which I've set as a pillar shall be God's house, and of all that he gives me, I will surely give a tenth to you." I will surely give a tenth to you. Look at that. It shows you understanding. What makes you think God will not take care of you in the journey when he has said it clearly in his word, that I'll never leave you nor forsake you, I'll be with you to the end of the age? What makes you think that God will not provide your needs when he said, "My God shall supply all my need"? When he said in Psalm 23 that the Lord is my shepherd, therefore I shall not want, and he makes me lie down in green pastures, he leads me beside still waters, he restores my soul. That's what David said. So David's prayer, it's very different from what Jacob was praying at this time. Remember, this time, Jacob had his first encounter. His first encounter with God, he didn't know God. His perception about God was, "Let me bargain. If God, you're going to provide me, take care of me, and give me this, give me that, then you will be my God." What a bargain. And it's so sad to say that most people are also still New Testament Christians after the death of Jesus. We now New Testament, we're born again. Some people still pray that prayer, conditional prayer. "God, if you do this, that for me, then you'll be my God." Ooh, that is you bargain with God? You want to bargain with God? So if he doesn't do it, does it mean he will not be your God? That's your choice. You see, you can't pray like that. You must change your theology. And that shows, like I said in the beginning, that a person's relationship, understanding about God, you know, a person's prayer reveals his understanding of God. All right? So that is for you. So you must change your perception about God. If you know that God is a good God, if you know that God supplies our need, you know that God will not mismanage your life. He's a kind father. then you start praying differently to him. Glory to God. So you see, the character of Jacob has not been totally altered in this encounter with God. Jacob's character has not been there. So because his perception of God was not right, he prayed like that. All right. So, but there's a man also in the Bible. Okay, but let me read this to you. Jacob had met God personally for the first time, and it has shaken him to his very core. Yet nothing seemed to change. He was unable to prevent himself from striking a bargain with God, in effect saying that he would keep his end of the bargain if God will keep his. All right? I believe we do the very same thing that Jacob did. The reason is that, like Jacob, we do not possess a correct concept of the nature of God. He really does want the best for us. I want you to just get that. God really wants the best for us. And so when you pray, you have to pray differently, all right? And then understanding the character of God will help us also with the content of our prayer. That one too, with the content of our prayer. Understand, content. If we believe that he's the creator of the universe and that everything which is good comes from his hand, it should help us inform in what and how we pray. All right? So it's also important to know and understand God, because it also helps you in the content of prayer, what to speak to him. I hope I'm being a blessing to somebody there. All right? Now, there's also another man who related to God differently and prayed differently. Elijah the prophet, my goodness. Elijah the prophet in 1 Kings chapter 18. Very interesting. He prayed differently. 1 Kings chapter 18 and from verse 27. I want to read that from 27. And so it was. I want to read it and explain to you what happened. And so it was at noon that Elijah mocked them and said, this is when he had had an encounter with the prophets of Baal. Most of you know the story. If you don't, go read it, okay, in 1 Kings 18, read the whole chapter. Elijah had an encounter with the prophets of Baal. Baal, which happens to be what their god, their main god. And everybody, you know, most of everyone of Israel started, Israel had become a nation of idol worshippers. They've left Yahweh. Jehovah was no more on the scene. And God sent a prophet called Elijah on the scene. And he threw a challenge to them, to these prophets, that let God, the God who answers by fire. So he came to an agreement with these prophets of Baal that they are going to call on their God, Baal, and he's going to call on his God, which is the true God, the only true God, even Yahweh. He was going to call on the true God, my goodness. So the stage was set for that encounter. I call it power encounter. There was a power encounter of two gods, and who was supposed to be the real God who answers by fire. And my goodness, when you listen to the content of Elijah's prayer, it tells you that he was a person who knew God and who understood God. So the content of his prayer was very different. All right? I want to read to you. Okay? And so it was that I'm just trying to save some time because my time is almost up and I want to pray with you. And so we'll continue that tomorrow and next week. Now, the stage was set and these prophets of Baal started crying out to their God, to Baal. From morning to evening, they were crying out and nothing was happening. Let me read what I have for you here. The story of Elijah and the prophets of Baal illustrate this concept. Elijah described the character of their God with his jeers. He told them, shout louder, surely he is a God. He started mocking them. They started praying, cry out, you know, and so it was at noon. I want to read from verse 27. That Elijah mocked them and said, cry aloud, for he is a God. Either he is meditating, or he is busy, or he is on a journey, or perhaps he's sleeping and must be awakened. So they cried aloud and cut themselves, as was their custom, with their knives, with knives and lances. until the blood gushed out of them. And when midday was past, they prophesied until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice. But there was no voice. No one answered. No one paid attention. Then Elijah said to all the people, "Come near to me." So all the people came near to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, "Israel shall be your name." Then with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench around the altar large enough to hold 2 seahs of seed. And he put the wood in order, cut the bull in pieces and laid it on the wood, and said, "Fill 4 water pots with water and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood." Then he said, "Do it the second time." And they did it a second time. And he said, "Do it a third time." And they did it a third time. So the water ran all around the altar, and he so filled the trench with water. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, listen to what he said. I know it's been long. He said, "Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, and I'm your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that these people may know that you are the Lord God, and that you have turned their hearts back to you again." Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the sacrifice. Wow. So you see, this is a man who was praying and knew and had an understanding of God. All right? Elijah said to all the people, "Come here to me." When he had their full attention, after he had them prepare the altar the way he wished, he prayed, "O Lord God of Isaac, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, let it be known." After the prayer, here we see a vivid picture of a man who knows his God. First, we see that he knows his heritage in him when he prays to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. When you know and understand that the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is still your God. He is still your God and hasn't changed. You know your heritage. It connects you to that covenant. Oh, the covenant that says he will never leave us nor forsake us. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Glory to God. He prayed like that. Connect himself to his heritage. Second, he knows that this God is a God of Israel, not Baal. Yes, furthermore, this God has elected a prophet and instructed him and will now vindicate him by responding to his prayer and by acting. Elijah knows his God. Yes, his heritage, his roots about, you know, and when someone stands to pray like that, loved one, you know that this is a person whose theology and paradigm about God is so strong. And so he speaks and knows that God will answer. Now, we in this 21st century believe that God can still answer prayer. Most of you believe that God can still answer prayer. But do you know him? Do you know his nature? It's very important. So I've just given you the introduction to when we pray. And when you pray, let's say that, I want to personalize. And when you pray, before you pray, have an understanding of God. Who is this God? And next week, I'm going to give you the 5 components about what we have to understand about him. And we stand to pray. Great things are going to happen this month. Great things. We're going to just speak to heaven, speak to our Father, and he's going to answer our prayer. I believe you want your prayers to be answered. You know, as much I also want my prayers to be answered. So let's get ready. Let's get ready. Let's get ready. Before, let's have an understanding of God. Who is this God that we talk to? Let's go back, build that foundation, and then we take off. Glory to God. I trust you've been blessed. My time is up. I have to be off. But don't miss any Wednesday of these prayer times. Share, invite people to join in, and let's pray together. Magabari tekosa. Shebre de gezeli mahanda sole le fe parite. Oh, yes, yes, yes. And we're going to share how when you want to pray according to God's will, you pray in the Spirit. And don't be ashamed to pray in the Spirit everywhere. So I pray for you, loved one, in the name of Jesus. I pray that this year, this month, God will open your eyes and your understanding to understanding who He is. And as we commune with Him in prayer and we have a dialogue with Him, He will speak back to you and give you clear-cut directions, give you divine directions as to where to go, what to do, and what not to do in the name of Jesus. I pray that God will reach out to you. I pray. Let this God who has taken care of you till now, let this God who has ordered your steps all through these years, let this God who has kept you and your family and loved ones, let this God who has helped you through difficult times still stand and rise up and speak to you again and again and again in the name of Jesus. May this God come through to you. May this God answer that prayer. May this God answer that prayer, because He's a prayer answering God in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. May your home be preserved. May your family be preserved. May the work of your hands be blessed in the name of Jesus. He does it all the time, and He's doing it now. He will bless you and bless you again and again and again, because you are the epitome of His creation. He has created you to be here to show forth His glory, and He will not put you to shame in the name of Jesus. Let God arise and His enemies be scattered. God will arise for you and His enemies be scattered. Glory to God. God bless you. And hey, next week I'm here again, but I will not go without giving some of you invitation. Anybody who's watching me there and believes this great God to make Him, His Son, Jesus, your Lord, your Savior, your forgiver, and it's a blessing. So if you are there, just pray this prayer with me and say, dear God, I come to you today just as I am. I receive Jesus into my heart to be my Lord, my Savior, my leader, my forgiver. Oh, glory to God. Thank you, Father, that I'm your child. In Jesus' name, my sins are forgiven. Yes, I believe, Jesus, that you died and you rose again the third day for my justification. Thank you. I'll follow you the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen and amen. If you've prayed that prayer, let's hear from you, loved one. Write to us, email us, tell us what the Lord has started doing for you this year. Hey, it's going to be a great year for you. Find a church, a Bible-believing church, and attend. Get a Bible, go there, and start your spiritual journey, your spiritual walk with Him, and grow. Grow in Him, and get to know Him better. And you will not regret knowing that God is your Father. He's a kind God. He's a good God. And if you happen to be around anywhere that we are, visit our website, www.vbci.org.uk. www.vbci.org.uk. Click on the branches and find out if any of our churches is closer to you and join them. And we are one big, big family, but in different locations. One church, but in different locations. God bless you and see you same time next week. God bless you. Until then, I have this for you. The rest of your days will be the best of your days. God bless you. Shalom.